Good evening. Thank you for coming. Very often with these panel discussions, one is given books to read, and you dutifully try and plow your way through. Or you read the beginning and the end, and you pretend that you know what they're about. But in this case, I must say, I read it from beginning to end with enormous pleasure. It's really an excellent book by Witold Sobieski. It's, I think, one of the finest examples of what I would call literary journalism. It's not pure reportage, it's literary, it's beautifully written, but it avoids the pitfalls of a lot of people who try to write in that way, which one of the pitfalls is that you put yourself forward all the time as kind of the main character, and the story you're trying to tell kind of disappears into the background. You don't do that. You learn a great deal about Turkey, where you spent several years, and you obviously know very well. And at the same time as learning a lot, you learn about you, but in a very subtle way, without you trying to sort of hog the spotlight. And it reads so beautifully in English that I can only assume that it reads even better in Polish. And it's going to be appearing in Dutch as well at Atlas Kontakt. And the Polish embassy actually had a contest, and various people were given a fragment of the book to translate into Dutch. And the winner, I think, is sitting here among us, called Gijs Fransen, and I think he needs or deserves a round of applause. So. Witek, if I may. My first question is because I've tried to do similar kinds of writing once in a while, is what your methods are when you approach a subject or a person you're going to write about. How do you do this? Do you do research beforehand? Do you read as much as you can about it, or do you simply go to a place or a situation or a person and see what happens and figure it out as you go along?
Good evening to everybody, and thank you for all the compliments. And with Turkey, that was very easy because I was there as a student, and you have to know that being a student in Turkey 12 years ago wasn't so easy. I mean, firstly, I had to go there, I had to find an agreement between Poland and Turkey that we exchange 4 students per year. Then I had to find a university that would accept me. And finally, with the letter from Professor, I remember this name and I will remember it until I die, Mehmet Kaya, saying, "Mr. Sobieski, please come, you're welcome." So I'm going to the point, but just I'm taking
the way around.
And I came with this paper to Professor Kaya 2 months later, and he said, "Nice to see you." We exchanged some nice words, but then he said that I must be wrong because they don't accept any students from Poland. And he took a big book with maps from the whole world, and he showed me we have students from Turkmenistan, we have students from Uzbekistan, we have even one Chinese student, but nobody from Poland. You must be wrong. And I said, "But Mr. Kaya, I have a letter from you saying that you're inviting me for this university." And then he said, "You know, in Turkey there is a word, yabancı. And you can use it for somebody from different religion, you can use it for stranger, for foreigner, but sometimes they use it in the context when somebody doesn't really understand everything properly, and they have special eyes. After a few months in Turkey, you start recognizing this." So that was the first time I experienced the yabancı look, and he told me, "Mr. Sobieski, I'm chief of department at this university. I'm signing every day 50 papers, 60 papers, 100 papers. How can I take responsibility for a paper that I had signed 2 months ago?" Which means I had a lot of time in Turkey as a student. I had the scholarship, but I didn't really attend university. They didn't really accept me. So all the reportage that you have in this book, I had so much time that I was traveling a lot. I was hitchhiking. I traveled around Turkey 4 times at that time, mostly by hitchhiking. So I made a competition, like, how quick can I hitchhike to, let's say, Şanlıurfa? And then I had the opportunity to make another circle with the best Turkish journalist as internship of CNN Turk. And that's when I collected material for half of the book. And then when I became a journalist of Gazeta Wyborcza, I just told them what stories I have, and they told me, okay, go. So then I had the chance to go back to the places which sometimes I crossed by hitchhiking and to collect the serious material.
So the first time you went there as a student, you were not going there with the intention to write about the place?
Not really, no. That was my dream, but I thought it would come a bit later. I had this dream, you know, when Chekhov, you know the story about young writer who came to Chekhov with his prose, and Chekhov read it and said, okay, it's pretty good, but now go and work few years in tundra, just cutting the trees, then go and work on the river. And I thought about this kind of life before I would start writing. So it came a bit earlier, I hope.
Why Turkey?
Completely by accident. I was studying political science in the times when we were about to join EU, and all my colleagues were very West-oriented. Like, they all wanted to make a career in Brussels, to go for scholarships or internships to London, Brussels, Berlin. And I'm trying always to be to look into the different directions that the crowd does. So I know that I'm telling a compliment to myself now, because actually everybody wants to be like this, but that's at least what I tried to do with the scholarship. When I saw that everybody's going west, I found this agreement between Poland and Turkey that we should send 4 students, and I just made them to send me.
And do you think that you mentioned somewhere where somebody says, well, we have a special friendship for the Polish people and so on, and when you are interviewing somebody, I can't remember exactly what the words were. Forgive me if I mention this name. It's a bit like in Sweden, you can really annoy people who are interested in film or are filmmakers, and you mention Ingmar Bergman, and they get very irritated. Why always Bergman? If I mention Richard Kapuscinski, it's because he's so famous in the West. He made a thing of being the sort of the Polish reporter for the Polish press agency when Poland was still a communist country, and traveling around the Third World in Africa and Latin America, and so that he was sort of treated differently from Americans or French or British reporters. Was there an element of that in Turkey? I mean, did they look at you differently being a Pole than they would if you'd been British?
Yes. Firstly, they remember the wave of Poles because in 80s, when we still had communism, there was a huge wave of Polish smugglers coming to Turkey. And you have this beautiful district in Istanbul called Aksaray, when there used to be shops called Vauensa, for example. There was a shop called Solidarity. There was a shop called Boniek, very famous Polish football player. And when you go there, they still remember a few phrases in Polish. So, and yeah, that was completely different than for any other nation. We, with Turks, lucky for our relationship, we don't have borders. They don't have too many Poles living there. We don't have too many Turks living in Poland. So we don't have too many fields that we could have conflicts on. Hmm. But actually, another interesting thing related to your question was the level of knowing Turkish. Like, at the very beginning, when you just can say merhaba, nasılsın, very easy, the very first words you learn, they were so happy that, oh, there is Yabancı trying to say something in Turkish. He's so cute. Like, always, you know, you're like teddy bear. Like, everybody wants to hug you. But then when I reached a bit better level of Turkish, that was interesting, because they get suspicious. Like, many of them grew up in the Cold War atmosphere, and especially when you go to the east of Turkey, and Turks say that when I speak Turkish, I have Azerbaijani accent. I don't know why, but the Azeri language is very funny for them. It's like you would be listening to English from 17th century, something like this. And but when they were meeting a Polish person speaking Turkish in the east of Turkey, they always got suspicious. And when I was preparing material for this book, police was called a couple of times that a strange guy is going around. Probably he's a spy. Please check it. But it's not related to my Polishness. So yeah, I went too far.
Did you ever get into trouble?
Not well. One reportage in this book is about honor killing, and we went. My interpreter, me, and the photographer. We went to one village when a woman was stoned, had been stoned. That's very rare for Turkey. You have many cases of honor killings, but not stoning. It's like from Middle Ages. And we went to that village, and they were very hospitable. They were very nice to us. But when we came to the right questions, we were pretty close from explosion of aggression. I think we ran away in the last moment. Mm-hmm. But except that, no, never. Mm.
Just to mention him once again, to what extent, when you grew up and wanted had dreams of being a writer and so on, was Kapuscinski a model? I mean, is he a huge presence for Polish writers of your generation, or not?
He definitely is, but I said once, and that's what I'm trying to do. I said in one interview that Kapuscinski should be read and forgotten because of two reasons. Firstly, because he went too high, and when you write nonfiction and keep thinking about Kapuscinski, you just get stressed and you don't write anything. You can just sit and think about how great Kapuscinski was. So that's the first reason. And the second reason is that simply, unfortunately, he will not write anything else. And the language is still changing and changing and changing. And Kapuscinski was great when it comes to the language, but still now when you read him, he's a bit old-fashioned, unfortunately.
And he had a great imagination. Does it bother?
Good that you're mentioning this. Yeah, that's what they say.
Well, yes.
For us, I mean, it's when you go to the east of Turkey, of course. Were you about to ask me if I use my imagination when I?
All right, I'll ask you that question.
It's impossible in the modern world when you are a reporter. It's just impossible because everything is in the internet. And people can check your facts that you're telling about. It's not 60s, like when Kapuscinski was working. Like, I did that research about honor killing, and there is a lady, I found one woman whose husband was strong enough to protect her. And I spent 2 weeks just trying to make these people talk. And it's in the book. And after the reportage was published in Gazeta Wyborcza, I got an email from a Polish woman who knew that person and knew that story. She was just a volunteer in one foundation which was supporting that family. So you cannot lie. It's just impossible. In the world, in the global village, you cannot be a reporter and overuse something.
I think there's another difference, too, between your generation and Kapuscinski's. One is that if he did use his imagination, and I think it's pretty clear he did, he often did it in countries that it was very difficult to check, more difficult than, say, Turkey. And he did it in parts of Africa where nobody really knew enough to ever sort of catch him. Mm-hmm. But the other, more important difference, and we can talk about Central and Eastern Europe in a minute, but is that, of course, he was operating when Poland was still behind the Iron Curtain. And there was a lot of interest in the West in writers, whether they were mostly fiction writers, but in his case, nonfiction or kind of nonfiction, because they were dissidents and because they were challenging the sort of the Soviet Empire in various ways and so on. And one of his most famous books again, probably imaginative in many ways, but is about the court of Haile Selassie. And when people say, well, he made a lot of it up, people say, well, but that's really a metaphor for dictatorship in Poland. Of course, your generation no longer has the benefit of being dissidents.
But we have the benefit of using metaphors. And I wrote a book which is very much, I mean, I don't want to compare my work to what Kapuściński did because he went too high, and as I told you. But when people were reading that book about Haile Selassie, there are some reports that some people in Great Britain thought it was about one director in one bank. In Poland, they thought it's the first secretary, Edward Gierek. So it was just a metaphor of leadership, but this like very specific way of leadership, like very dictatorship way of leading people. But I think that my way of thinking about literature comes a little bit from this metaphoric, can I say, mm-hmm. so? Metaphoric way of thinking, because my last book is exactly built on this way. Can I say that?
Yes, of course. Yeah.
It's called Dancing Bears, and the concept of it came to me when I heard the story of Dancing Bears of Bulgaria. Like maybe you know that in Bulgaria was the last country in whole Europe where training bears for dancing was prohibited. Until that moment, the bears had been trained, like they had a hook, they had a ring in nose, so they were pulled all the time and they had to make...
Bears, I kept on thinking birds, and why would birds be trained to dance?
But how you pronounce
dancing
it properly?
Bears.
Bears.
Yeah, beer, yeah.
Dancing bears, not
yeah.
birds.
Yes.
Yeah. And not...
Well, dancing birds would be fascinating, but it's...
Sorry, we are very badly educated in Eastern Europe. That's why. That's where my accent comes from. Dancing bears.
No, we've got it. We've cleared it up now. Bears, yeah.
Bears.
Yeah.
So they were dancing like this. Horrible torture for animals. So gypsy used to train them to do that. And suddenly, Bulgaria was joining EU, so EU came... told to the gypsies, oh, they're gypsies, you are barbarians. You shouldn't train these poor animals like this. Took the
bear.
The animals. Took the animals, and that's the point. They opened a special preservation place for them, which is a laboratory of freedom. They teach them how to hunt. They teach them how to hibernate. They teach them how to make little children. They teach them freedom. They teach them all the things that they've never tried before. So the first part of the book is just step by step how to teach this creature what freedom is and how you do that step by step. But then you have the second part when I'm writing about the laboratory that we have had in Eastern Europe for the last 25 years. When I compare the situation of these creatures to the situation of Poles, Slovaks, Ukrainians, Russians, Albanians, and when I try to say what's different, how it is to teach an animal what freedom is, and is it far different from teaching a human being what freedom is?
Why do you think the Poles have done relatively better than many other Eastern Europeans? I mean, they stopped being dancing bears quite a while ago. I mean, before 1989, and you had Solidarity and so on. I mean, the Poles have done pretty well if you compare them, say, to the Hungarians today, or let alone the Romanians or the Bulgarians. Why do you think that is?
Very hard question. I think we... we knew what freedom was. I mean, we had it, and we knew before how hard it is. We hadn't had freedom for 123 years, but we had kept fighting for that. And we had it back for 20 years only at the beginning of the 20th century, and then we lost it for next few dozens of years, and I think that's where it comes from, that we knew the price, but we knew how valuable it is.
It may also be something else, which is to do also with your reading of Turkey, because quite accurately, you make a big thing of that there are really two Turkeys and they're constantly struggling. You have the sort of, and Istanbul is almost a metaphor of it. You have the sort of the Turkey that looks to Europe, that wants to be part of Europe, that is westernized and idolized Ataturk, secularism and so on. And then you have the other Turkey that is more Islamic, that feels part of more sort of a nostalgia for the Ottoman Empire, that's more Eastern and so on. And of course, Russia is a similar country where there's constantly been struggles between sort of Asian Russia and Western Russia and so on. Poland, could one say, was the most European of Eastern European countries?
I don't know. For me, like, Turkey in this book is kind of metaphor of Poland, actually, to be honest.
Uh-huh.
That because I think we are so similar to Turks because we are also divided between modernity and the past, and we still don't know. We want to be conservative or we want something completely different. So for me, Turks are very similar to Poles at that point.
But that, in the case of Poland, may have something to do with the Catholic role of the Catholic Church.
Yeah, it might.
But what you don't have in Poland, I don't think, certainly not in the last several hundred years, is what you have in Russia or you have in Turkey, is that half of the country kind of felt that they belonged to a non-Western world. Or was it like that?
No, never. Like this, never. But it's interesting when you compare Poland and Turkey, when you have elections and it's the same for Poland and for Turkey, and I think for many countries, that you have one party which is conservative and the other party which is quite liberal. And when you see a map of Turkey, the whole west of Turkey is voting for the Ataturk's party, which is more liberal, and the whole east is voting for AKP, the ruling party. And it's the same when you have a look at map of Poland. East of Poland is voting, east and a bit of south is voting for the conservative party, and the west for the more liberal. So, and there is many similarities, but of course, we've never had anybody who would like Poland join, I don't know, Asia or Russia or the ex-Soviet Union, nothing like this.
What you did have, of course, is that Poland felt deeply betrayed by the West, because after all...
Of course we did.
Yeah. And rightly so.
We do until now, I mean...
You still
sometimes,
do.
Sometimes, yeah.
And how does that manifest itself?
There is not too many manifestations, but I mean, it's based in the past. It's not that you're betrayed. But you're not doing
betrayed
this
betrayed by dancing
you're
bears.
You're not doing this now. Now we are pretty fair. You West, I mean. But, yeah, I mean, people remember in Poland, we are very, like, you can't believe how, for example, the historical reconstruction, can I say so? Like, you know, guys, there's so many young people who spent hours and hours just making kind of, you know, old uniforms and then pretending they are making battles. I don't think there is a country where this kind of reconstructions would be so popular. Every newspaper has its supplement about history. We are like we are so concentrated in the past that it's really hard to talk with someone about the future in Poland. Like the government is planning only, the government doesn't have any plan for Poland for next 5 years. Their policy is just, you know, the prime minister is waking up, taking a newspaper, and then he knows what to do this day. That's how they are planning.
That sounds like pretty
but
much every country.
You know, our president is historian by education. Our prime minister, the last one, he's now the president of Europe, he was a historian by education. So many politicians are historians, and it's really hard, you know, to live in a country which keeps talking about the past all the time. Now I'm writing a book about the World War II, so...
What aspect of World War II?
The conflict between Poles and Ukrainians.
Ah, that's a very good subject, because that's very under... nobody knows about it.
Yeah, but I'm writing from the... We had some clashes between Poles and Ukrainians. They were killing us, we were killing them, and now we are like, we have competition who killed more. But I'm trying to not write about from perspective of people who were killing, but I want to write about people who were rescuing their neighbors. So I'm going from village to village trying to find such stories.
Mm-hmm. to get back to Turkey for a second, one thing I find very intriguing and sympathetic, because it sort of fits my own interests and approach as well, your approach to understanding Turkey and what's going on in Turkey and the tensions in Turkish society, you focus very strongly on sexual relations. I mean, not just honor killings, but also the way men treat women and their ideas about virginity and marriage and so on. And you very clearly bring out the differences between the Turkey you see in Istanbul amongst the middle classes and then the people in Anatolia and so on. But you get the impression the differences between those two Turkeys are not perhaps as wide as one might assume. And am I right in that the people in westernized Istanbul pretend to be much more progressive and complete, much more liberated and so on, but you seem to draw up a more complicated picture?
That's how the book begins, that I see that this division between East and West, between religion and Islamophobia, like every Turk has such a division in himself or herself.
Yes.
And I start with a picture of a ferry, that Istanbul is the only city in the world where you can go from continent to continent in 15 minutes by ferry, or in 5 minutes just crossing a bridge. But I believe that every Turk has such a division, that they keep traveling between Europe and Asia all the time. Like, whenever they have to make a decision, they have to make a journey between Europe and Asia and ask themselves which part they choose for this in this particular moment. And sometimes they choose Europe, sometimes they choose Asia. And to be honest, I have so many friends there. And I don't have anybody who would be 100% European or 100% Asian. And even my closest friends then can surprise me. Like, I had 2 years ago, I was invited for a wedding, and because it's a very good friend of mine, I went with my mother. And we were like special guests, so we were sleeping in the bride's parents' apartment, and I didn't know why the bride's mother didn't treat us nicely. I knew there is a problem, but I couldn't figure out what the problem was. And I realized that, and I wrote a book about Turkey. I think I understand them a little bit, but it took me 6 months to understand that the problem was that my mother is divorced. And divorced woman in Turkey, and these people who are our hosts, they are liberal. They are traveling to Europe. They are living like European middle class life, but still, being divorced woman, and they have a picture of divorced woman in their DNA. It's under the skin. So when they see divorced woman, they don't think, okay, she will not have a romance with my husband. No, they just react with their culture code.
Even in
this middle European class. So that's what I call traveling between Europe and Asia, that normally they are in Europe, but seeing my mother, divorced woman, they just made a quick trip to Asia.
What about people who are already very close to Asia? I mean, villagers in near the Syrian border, say. Do they sometimes make a quick trip to Europe?
Like, I don't know them too much. But
what, you've traveled there? And, yeah. And the village of the woman who got stoned, for example.
I mean, they travel there whenever they turn TV on.
I see.
And that's the problem with honor killings, that young people, young girls, they watch TV. They want to live like their colleagues in the West. And that's when the problems begin. Because the family wants to keep, you know, this little village kind of living, and the girls watch TV, and that's the journey to Europe for them. And the family doesn't want the girl to travel to Europe. They want to keep her. So, and that's usually happens not with the girls, with the strongest, unfortunately. I mean, it's always bad, but it's for the girls who want to change their life. That's when it happens, when they want to make a change.
Yeah, that's when it always happens. And you told me earlier, when we were talking, I think yesterday, that you wanted to interview Erdogan. And it didn't pan out because he saw you
I'm
coming
fascinated.
From a long way.
I'm fascinated now, with Tayyip. They call him Tayyip.
Uh-huh.
It's his middle name, like his Recep Tayyip Erdogan.
Because he seems a very good example of what you're saying, of somebody who's constantly taking these trips, because he's an Islamist. He became the leader of his country. He seemed to be moving closer to the EU than the military regimes were before, and yet now he's sort of going completely the other way. What is your analysis of where he is?
I'm fascinated with this personality. He's a natural-born politician, and maybe he would never learn that he's a politician because he was just a clerk, you say? Mm-hmm. He was working in an office. He was responsible for buses in Istanbul. And my chapter about Erdogan is called Mustache Republic because Islamists in Turkey, you know, in Turkey you can recognize a politician by mustache. And Islamists, they have like very short mustache, like 3 millimeters. And he had, because he was very, he was devoted Muslim, so he had this kind of mustache. And one day his director called him and said, Mr. Tayyip, we are living in a country where religion, where you cannot promote religion. You are working for municipality. You have to shave your mustache. And Tayyip said, I'd rather die than shave my mustache. So the next day, he became a member of the Islamist party. And 4 years later, he became a mayor of 15 million city Istanbul. So he's so talented. That's amazing. And he's an animal, political animal, like very few in Europe, I think, now, and very few in the whole world. But what do I think about
what happened to his mustache?
He still has it.
Ah.
He's
and there were other two.
He will never shave it.
There were two other kinds.
But the same about the ex-president Abdul Gül, same mustache. They all have it.
But there are two alternative mustaches that you also describe.
Three. The nationalists, they have like this. Socialists have only here. But it's of course, it's never 100% true. But when you see, you can check Turkish politicians. But that's also for Poland. When I did a book about the People's Republic of Poland, there was a lot about mustache. Like in the 80s, all the opposition people had mustache. All the guys from party, like Jaruzelski, shaved. In KC, like where you meet the most important politicians, only one guy had a beard and mustache. Only one. And in the opposition, probably only one didn't have.
Mm-hmm.
So mustache and beard, it's very political thing, actually. Yeah. You can manifest it a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
But in general, I think Erdogan is a genius. And it's actually pretty bad news that he's a genius because he's in this journey between Europe and Asia, I think he has already decided to go to Asia.
You were asked, nearing the end, you were asked whether you would read a bit of your book, and you adamantly refused. Would you mind terribly if I read a little bit from your book?
I would love to.
Because I think it'd be good for people to sort of get a taste of the style. And this is the shortest chapter. It's the last one. It's entitled "That's Turkey for You," and it's about bathing suits. And the first sentence is: "Lately, bathing suits for Muslim women have been a huge hit in Turkey. They completely cover the legs and arms and have sweet little hoods to go over the head. Most of them also have a matching cape, so the material won't hug the body and reveal the ins and outs of the figure." And then a little later, you say, "The bathing trunks for men have longer than standard legs." So this is the bathing trunk theory of Turkey rather than the moustache theory. "According to Mehmet Sahin, owner of a company called Hasema and designer of the first costumes, quote, when I was a student, I felt very embarrassed going to the beach. In classic bathing trunks, I felt as if I were naked. That was when it occurred to me, this is a gap in the market. A few years later, I began production of the first costumes. The Muslim female swimmers have stirred a good deal of commotion at Turkish resorts, leading to a number of fights between modern pro-Western Turks and the religious ones who've spoilt the first lot's view as well as their fun. So the newspaper Hürriyet published a picture of two women standing side by side, up to their waists in the water. One was in a Muslim costume, covering everything except her eyes. The other was topless. "That's Turkey for you," ran the editorial commentary. So you're very good at metaphors.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.